discusses dialogue, narration, and pacing, and those are two
Andy
really
came to
cute babies.
In early 1947 for murdering his wife.
They may or may not be mine.
On the outside, he'd been vice president of a large Portland bank. Good work.
We just wanted to look at him for a long time.
Okay, so narrative is the first term we need to talk about. And hopefully you recognize this from talking about narrative nonfiction, which was true story. Narrative just means a story. They're synonyms. Sit down. Let me tell you a story. Once upon a time, I ate your hamster this morning. Oops.
All right, dialogue. Dialogue is a conversation between two or more people in a story. We saw it in Romeo and Juliet.
And with dialogue, you have quotations around whatever the characters are saying.
I understand you had a pretty rough time.
Yeah, it was pretty bad.
Cigarette?
Yes, I know.
Well, do you feel up to any questions?
I'll try.
Where were you when all this happened?
I was right here at my desk working.
And when was the first time you noticed something was wrong?
Well, when I first heard the shot, and as I turned, Jim fell.
He's a teller, Frank.
Jim Fell's a teller?
No, Jim Johnson.
Who's Jim Fell?
Well, he's the auditor, Frank.
He had the flu, so Jim filled in.
Phil who?
Filled in. He's the night watchman, Frank.
Fully, Phil had been here.
Right, now, wait a minute. Let me get this straight. Twice came in and shot the teller and Jim Fell.
No, he only shot the teller, Jim Johnson. Fell is ill.
Okay, then after he shot the teller, you shot twice.
No, I only shot once.
Twice is the holdup, man.
Then I guess I did shoot twice.
Well, so now you're changing your story.
No, I shot twice after Jim fell.
You shot twice and Jim fell?
No, Jim fell first, and then I shot twice once.
Well, who fired twice?
Once.
Now, he's the owner of the tire company, Frank.
Okay. Once is the owner of the tire company, and he fired twice. Then twice shot the teller once.
Twice.
And Jim fell, and then you fired twice.
Once.
Okay. All right, that'll be all for now, Miss Decker.
I will need you to make a formal statement down at the station.
Oh, of course.
You've been very helpful. We think we know how he did it.
Oh, how he couldn't have done it. He hasn't been in for weeks.
Okay, so that's an example of dialogue. Why was that your favorite? Was that your favorite conversation?
It's just a very funny conversation because it's confusing.
Okay. So dialogue helps you to understand characters. It creates interest in the story. It's really boring to read a story without anybody talking. It moves the story along faster sometimes. It reveals secrets about what characters are thinking about doing or what they're thinking in general. And it helps to set the tone, too. So an example of dialogue over here on the right side, think about the tone of this conversation. How could you? I trusted you and you cheated on me. Oh, sorry, Dad. That was meant for Jim. Oh, on a completely unrelated topic, have you seen my shotgun anywhere?
That was a very sexist man voice.
Well, anyway, that was an interesting conversation that reveals some thoughts that the characters might be having. It creates interest, it moves the story along, and it helps to set the tone.
Okay, so narration. A commentary that accompanies a story. The act or process of telling, narrating a story. But this is the important part. It only refers to the action of the story. It's not so much a description as it's telling events that happen in the story. And here's one of the great narrators of our time.
Oh, I love Shawshank Redemption.
Andy came to Shawshank Prison in early 1947 for murdering his wife and the fella she was banging. On the outside, he'd been vice president of a large Portland bank. Good work for a man as young as he was.
Hey, Red.
Okay, so what's the purpose of narration? Well, the narrator is the person, animal sometimes, or object who tells the story. And so it helps to have somebody narrating because otherwise It would be like all you got is the dialogue, and while dialogue is nice, you have to have the story to go along with it. So the narrator's biases and opinions can affect the reader's opinion of the story and characters. If they, for example, think that, I don't know, let's say Romeo is just like a total love-struck, sappy character who just is annoying, then that's going to affect our interpretation of Romeo. Point of view is the perspective from which the story is told, which we talked about earlier this year, and the point of view affects how much information the reader is allowed to know.
So the little picture there kind of shows you, depending on who the narrator is, you're definitely going to get a different point of view. The king's going to say, hey, everything's peachy, and the people are going to be like, dude, we're starving, feed us. Okay, so there's your point of view and how it affects the narration.
Okay, so just some examples here. See if you can match up the type of narration to the examples on the right. So look at those quotes. Which one would be first person using I and we? Which one would be second person using you to directly address the reader? A lot of times you see this in like directions or a letter. And which one would be third person using he, she, and they to talk about characters? Okay, so description and imagery. Description is like narration, only it is the part of the prose where it just describes something instead of talking about events. So description explains or describes the appearance, smell, mood, or other characteristics of anything. So an example of appearance as an author, an example of description that an author might use for appearance would be like, he had blue eyes, a big nose, and curly brown hair. That's description. That's not narration because there's no events happening there. An example of description where you're describing location, two stands of tall oak trees dripping with ivy lined the long, narrow driveway. So description, which is also known as imagery, helps you as the reader to visualize the story in your mind, and that is why an author might use it. But it's usually more beneficial in small doses, otherwise it really slows the pace of the story down.
Okay, pacing, how fast or slow the story unfolds. So partially determined by the length of the story, and the authors have many techniques, which we're going to cover real quick, they can use to adjust the pace of their story.
And it helps us to know the author's pacing techniques, because when we are analyzing a story and talking about what makes it effective and interesting, that way you have the tools to talk about how the author paces their story effectively. Okay, so like pacing technique number one, the author might use action. Action scenes show what's happening in a story. Usually they're short and medium length sentences because readers get through them faster, therefore increasing the pace. Authors include few distractions, little description, and omit most character thoughts. So it's just bang, 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 lots of stuff happening in a row. Like the parts of the Hunger Games novel where it's just one thing after another happening during the rebellion, that would be an example of action quickening the pace. Or when Katniss is in the arena and lots of stuff happens in a row.
Okay, the example there is from Murph, I forget the name of it. But as they're fighting for the first however long they're fighting, it's usually one-word comments or one-word commands, and they just know what to do. There's not a whole lot of distraction or talking to bug people through the action.
Okay, so pacing technique number two would be cliffhangers, which you should be familiar with this word. Cliffhanger is when the outcome of a scene or chapter is left hanging. Hence the term cliffhanger. So for example, you might have unfinished actions, unfulfilled needs, and interruptions. The pace naturally picks up because of these cliffhangers, because the reader will turn the page to find out what happens next. We want to know what happens. And when a cliffhanger happens at the end of the novel, that really makes us want to read the next novel, the sequel. So readers both love and hate uncertainty, and that's why cliffhangers help to speed up the pace.
All right, dialogue. Rapid-fire dialogue is swift and captivating. So this could be like arguments, confrontations, power struggles that quicken the pace. And they're usually really short, kind of quick blurbs.
Let's act this out, okay? I'll do the green and you do the gray.
Okay. So, here's an example. Oh, your great aunt just passed away, LOL.
Why is that funny?
It's not funny, David. What do you mean?
Mom, LOL means laughing out loud.
Oh my goodness. I sent that to everyone. I thought it meant lots of love. I have to call everyone back. Oh God.
I just realized that we defied the rules of stereotyping who should be a guy and who should be a girl, because you totally just played a mom and I played David.
Good word. That's how we roll.
Okay, pacing technique 4 is prolonged outcomes. I don't know what this picture has to do with it. Mr. Childs will talk about that. Okay, so while it may seem that prolonging an event would slow down a story, it actually increases the speed because the reader wants to know if the character is rescued from the mountainside, if the vaccine will arrive before the outbreak decimates the village, or if the detective will solve the case before the killer strikes again. So once in a while, prolonged outcomes will increase the pace of the story.
All right, so I don't know if you watch this show because I think it's been canceled, but this is A to Z, and I think it's Adam and Zelda or something like that. And the basis of this entire TV show is their relationship from beginning to end. So they try to draw the crowd or the audience in to watch because they want to see what happens next in this relationship. So it's kind of a prolonged story that they want to keep you coming back for more every time.
All right, so pacing technique 5, a series of incidents in rapid succession, similar to series of unfortunate events series. The author can create events that happen immediately after one another. There's minimal transitions, leaping via scene cuts from scene to scene and place to place. So we're seeing this theme of the more action you have and the faster the actions occur, the quicker the pace is.
All right, so short chapters and scenes, this one kind of makes sense. Its short segments are easily digested, and they end quickly. Since they relate a complete action, the reader passes through them quickly, as opposed to being bogged down by long descriptions and lengthy paragraphs and long chapters. If you've read the story of Jessica Lynch, usually her thing is broken down in very short segments. There's a few places in there where it's literally a paragraph is what they use for an entire segment of that book, and then it skips to a different scene totally.
Yeah, everybody loves reading those novels for school where you only have a page per chapter because you really feel like you're flying through the material. Okay, pacing technique 7 is summarizing. Authors can summarize whole eras, descriptions, and backstory for readers to trim their word count and reserve scenes for the major events. That's really all we care about. We don't need to know what happens in the 7 years that the guy was in the wilderness with no electricity. All we want to know is a summary of what happened, and then we want to see what happens as soon as there starts to be action. Like, if he's going to fight a bear or a mountain lion, we want to see that. But we don't want to hear about all of the water that he drank and the blankets that he fashioned out of tree bark. Summarizing works well when time passes, but there is nothing to report when an action is repeated or when a significant amount of time has passed.
So, the Hunger Games here, if you think about it, most of you guys have either read it or seen it, they don't cover what happened in the beginning. They don't cover why Pan Am separate from everybody. They just kind of do a quick summary of, oh, there was a war, and now we're all stuck in our own little colonies. So, that's an example. Even though it's a really long book, she shortened it by cutting out a big chunk of the time.
Okay, pacing technique 8 is word choice. Writers can use concrete words like prodigy and iceberg and potent verbs like zigzag, as in the picture, and plunder. Harsh consonant sounds like in the words claws, crash, kill, quake, and nag can push the reader ahead. Words with unpleasant associations, also known as connotations, can ratchet up speed, like hiss, grunt, slither, venomous, and wince. Those words just naturally quicken the pace over, let's say, what's a really boring word? Get, like,
well,
have.
The one above, instead of saying the player ran down the field, it's much more exciting to say the player zigzagged around the defense while running down the field or something, just adding to it.
Yeah, and energetic active language helps to build suspense, drama, and conflict, thereby quickening the pace.
All right, sentence structure. Long sentences and unnecessary wordiness slow a reader down. So this is just a quick Google search for the longest English sentence that I could find. Traditionally, the longest sentence in English literature has been said to be a sentence by in Ulysses by James Joyce, which clocks in at 4,391 words for a sentence.
That's like, how many pages double space would that be, I'm thinking? Probably like 8 pages, 8 yeah, to 10 pages double space. So that's ginormous. If you put sentences like that, labyrinthine sentences, you're definitely slowing your reader down. Boring.
I'm giving up after the first 1,500.
Yeah. So. Okay. And that is dialogue, narration, and pacing. See you in class. Now I have to go make items.